Everybody. In some respects, I prefer it. He came and picked me up and he walks in.
No shit. I leave this in Memphis, you know.
Your little Siri lied to you. Said, let's confuse him. Siri is Siri, whatever her name is.
Siri,
I call her Ashley.
That really pisses her off.
I've got a few videos I'm going to play to get the technology right. It's a little bit archaic, so bear with me.
You know I smoked a lot of grass. Oh, Lord, I popped a lot of pills. But I've never touched nothing. My spirit could kill. You know I've seen a lot of people walking around with tombstones in their eyes. But the butcher don't care. Oh, if you live or if you die. God damn, hey, I say the pusher. I say God damn, the pusher man.
Thank you.
high like smoking lightning. Heavy metal thunder racing with the wind. And the feeling that I'm under. Yeah, I gotta go make it happen. Take the world in a loving embrace. Fire all of your guns at once and explode into space.
Okay, there's going to be a short glimpse of Bruce here at 16 years of age. That came awfully quick.
Here we go.
Albert, there's Albert. Here we go. I'm going to play it again. There's Bruce. There's Bruce again!
I have that side of my face.
That was 8mm film that I threw some little song to it.
Danny? No, that's not Danny.
Back in the day.
Somebody find that poster.
Yeah, I still have that poster. It's in my son's house. He's probably smoking a bong right now. So this is Paul's apartment, 1983. The whole neighborhood's in this one. Bruce will make an appearance, but it is brief. Darby Lee. There's Richard. There's Wes. Yeah. That's me, baby! There's my mama. That's my brother Chris. There's my brother Philip. There's Bruce. Here he goes again. There I am smoking the big one. There's my dad. That's some classic stuff right there. Somebody stoned. I believe this next song in all of our lives right now pretty much says it all.
Stood there bowling, sweating in the sun.
You're great, honey. Thank you.
Felt like a million. Felt like number one. The height of summer. I never felt that strong. Like a rock. I was 18. Didn't have a care. Working for peanuts, not a dime to spare. But I was leaning, solid everywhere, like a rock. My hands were steady, my eyes were clear and bright.
Yeah.
My walk had purpose, my steps were quick and light.
Thank you.
Yeah. Next video is a compilation of all the pictures that I owned of Bruce and I since the accident in my home office. I played this slideshow 24 hours a day to the album by Rush, Caress of Steel, which was one of Bruce and I's favorite albums. So it's amazing what you can do with technology. I took current pictures taken on people's iPhones, old videos from 8mm silent movies, still shots that I've had since we were 17, took pictures of all of them, put them in a file folder, played music in the background, played the slideshow on my home computer and filmed it with an iPhone. So that's what it took to get to what we're fixing to watch here.
Damn technology, thank you for that hard.
I found a dance that's wonderful.
Rock on, brother.
Thank you, Paul.
Bruce and I never travel without a flask. Oh, it's bigger than the hole. Imagine that. Bruce, brother, it's bigger than the hole. To Bruce. Girl up, Bruce's girl, love of his life.
Come on, baby.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, yeah.
Shit out of your way.
I might need some of them.
Oh, okay.
First of all, I want to thank everybody for showing up. I really appreciate it. You just don't know. I know it's been 6 months that I put this off, but I wanted to be able to walk in here and do this. So, I wanted to tell y'all how we met is what my story is going to be, because he was so silly. There was a group of us going to Little Sturgis, Kentucky for a bike rally, and he just was one of the guys, you know, and he didn't have the job at Lucite yet, so he didn't think he was going to be able to afford to go, so a bunch of us pitched in to help him go. He didn't bring his bike. He rode in the truck with me, hauling all the luggage and coolers and tents and everything. And that's when we first started talking, because he was, you know, have you ever been married? I'm like, yeah. And he said he hasn't. And it just started out from there. And he was always hanging around after the trip, you know. Everywhere I went, he was there. I'm like, what the hell, man? And, you know, like, the guy I was dating at the time, he just got a motorcycle and he didn't know how to ride. So Bruce would volunteer to ride me. And thank God he did, because it wasn't short after that I split up with the guy and he got his my phone number from him. He said, is it okay if I call Cassie? And he was like, yeah, call her. Me and Donna were at Las Reyes in Mumford having a beer on the patio, and Bruce called me. What are you doing? This is Bruce. I'm like, what the hell? Okay. And he invited me to come out and have a beer at Shack Rag, and I never went a day without seeing him or calling him or anything. And he had once told a friend that he wasn't going to give up on me just because I was seeing somebody else, that, you know, he was going to wait that time out. He done found the love of his life, that he was going to marry this girl. And he did. He asked me to marry him on my daddy's birthday. We were up at the Tennessee River, and I have it wrote down on my friend Tara's. They had a...
I have it on my phone in a little napkin.
Well... What? Okay. You know, screw me up, girl. Anyway, so we were up at the Tennessee River at Tara's camper, and he asked me to marry him, and, you know, you sign the bathroom door. That's what we did for her, and that's why I wrote down, spectacular things happen. The love of my life asked me to marry him. And then he said, and Bruce said, yes, I did, and he will love me till the last breath he took, and he did.
He did indeed,
he
baby.
Did. He was the most wonderful man. I will never find anybody else like him. I know there's lots of wonderful people in this world, but that one was my soulmate. And I will never forget him or never stop loving him. Okay, that's it.
Okay, baby. Wow. Man. For those of you who do not know who I am Bruce's brother. My name is Paul Paycheck. And Bruce is my brother. Not by blood, but by soul and spirit. I believe one's journey to God is not achieved by one lifetime on earth, but by many. I also believe that Bruce and I have crossed paths. In previous lifetimes. And we will again have many adventures. God damn. Man, I can't even see. Yeah, well, they're my readers. Okay, bear with me. We both stated many, many, many times that if we could choose how we were going to exit this planet, that we would choose leaving this planet on our Harley Davidsons or making love. He beat me to the Harley Davidson. So with any luck, I'll die making love. On my bike. It was 1965 when the Paycheck family moved from Neely Road and Shelby Drive to Tammy Lane in the Garden View subdivision. Lynn Jeffries already lived on Tammy Lane, and it was he whom I first met at the age of 5. Lynn, where are you? My brother right there. Brian came right afterwards. The Kingdons moved in not much long after that. Along came Keith, Bruce, and Karen. Their dad was a professional photographer. Their mom was, as most of our moms were back in the day, a stay-at-home mom. I remember Mr. Kingdon had built their bunk beds and their dresser drawers and all of this furniture. He was a carpenter just like my father was. I also remember that Mrs. Kingdon answered the door, and if she did, she's going to ramble on about her day, whether her kids were home or not, you know, and you learned at a very early age how to politely excuse yourself when an adult just kept on rambling on and talking. So we learned that from Mrs. Kingdon, and like most moms back in that time, you know, she was always feeding us. So Bruce was a couple of years younger than I was, and we hit it off just fine and dandy. He was from the beginning my most special friend. We explored our limits of the street that we lived on until we were old enough to expand our boundaries. Then it was the concrete gully behind our house. It was the apartment complex where Brian lived, the stop and go, the 8 days in, and eventually we discovered the woods off of Nelly, where the pond was. And finally, there was Owl's Golf Haven. And though our boundaries would expand as we got older to include McKellar Park, the Southland Mall parking lot, the church on the river hanging out at the railroad tracks over the bridge, the Pizza Inn on Shelby Drive, we always felt most comfortable
back home on Tammy Lane. At the age of 10, I got my first set of drums, and I discovered, it was the discovery of self came to me. It was being a musician. I started emulating the rock stars of that day. It was Led Zeppelin, The Who, Queen, David Bowie, Free, Trapeze, Uriah Heep, Grand Funk Railroad, Three Dog Night, and many others. I remember getting my first set of Levi bell bottoms and a wide leather belt and stacked shoes, and I top it off with a bandana. And it never left me. There you go. Bruce followed suit. And by the time we were teenagers, you couldn't tell us apart unless you looked at our legs. Because I was so bow-legged, I couldn't pin a pig in a pit, and he was pigeon-toed. So that's how you could tell us apart. I like the rest of my family, never mind being the center of attention. This trait, indeed, came from both of my parents, who loved to sing and dance, had a great sense of humor. Bruce, on the other hand, he was a quiet one. But if amongst true friends, he could let it out and act really goofy, and just, it was rare to see, but he could be a person that you weren't used to seeing. He sat back and observed. Maybe because it was, you know, he was the youngest one in the group on Tammy Lane, but he just sat back and observed everything. As high school came around, Bruce went to Hillcrest. I wound up at a prep school, God forbid. But the neighborhood was our world. He met a girl named Roxanne, and they had a baby girl at the age of 16. Nicole, you are definitely the love of your daddy's life. He talked to me about you often. He loves you dearly. Bruce would soon pick up a Les Paul guitar. Growing his hair long, he would jam from time to time. Though we never formed a band, we did jam often. Also with Kim Walker, over here filming today's event. The McAfee family moved in around 1975, and along came Joe, Stella, Margaret, and Daryl, who were the McAfees, and with Gary Brock, Richard Wilson, Kim Walker, and others, they completed the neighborhood. They fit right in, and we all discovered a bond with one another that exists to this day. And our mom, Mrs. McAfee, who could not be here today, sends her love to her lost son, Bruce. Bruce and I always talked about living together one day. But I was a couple of years older, so I was the first one to move out. I briefly lived with a dear friend of ours, Andy Newton. And Bruce was with us on the day we moved out. It was in the video. My brother was there. We were all smoking weed. And Bruce looked like he was 12 years old, smoking weed right with us. We lived in the Clearbrook Village apartments, two bedroom, two bath with a washer and a dryer for $192 a month. What a life.
Definitely just dated yourself.
Yeah, I did. Then I lived with my bass player, Doug Garrison, for 4 years. And through all these... And after that, I lived with Wes Hassel for a couple of years, another dear friend of ours. We lost Wes just 2 years ago. Though all through these years, Bruce and I were very tight. And then time came to pass when we would live together. For the first time, we rented a home, but we needed another roommate. So hence, Dave Johnson, Dave from Three Doors Down, moved in with us. We had the coolest home on a 1 acre lot at Lamar in Winchester on Clearpool Circle, dude. We used to walk across the street to that club that was open till 6 in the morning. There's a strip club around the corner. It was the house of houses. We all three had jobs, and we truly didn't have a care in the world. We would come home, cut our lawn on Friday night with this piece of shit riding lawnmower, have beers hanging around our neck. I am convinced that we invented the huggy with the shoestring, okay? Because we were stoned and we figured shit out. You know, we just figured it out. We threw epic Halloween costume parties where everybody dropped a hit of acid. You had to show up in costume and you stayed all night. The three of us were doctors one year. Dave Johnson was Dr. Hit a Nerve, so he was a dentist. Bruce was Dr. Feel Good. I was Dr. Feel You Better. I'm a gynecologist. We had white coats, name tags, and stethoscopes. We dropped our hit of acid before we drove to the Piccadilly. On our way there, we passed an accident, and we actually stopped, got out, in our white coats and stethoscopes, and we asked the police officer, is anybody hurt here? And he said, no, it's all good. And we were sweating bullets. I was so glad that nobody was hurt, because we just bullshitted our way through life so many times at events like that. So we wound up at the Piccadilly, and we ate our full meal, and then we went back and we tripped for 6 hours with 40 of our friends in costume. Now, earlier I told you that Bruce was the quiet one. Well, that was only until the Quaaludes and the whiskey kicked in. Because my brother Bruce had an alter ego of Superman, which nearly got our asses kicked more than once. He wouldn't take shit off of anybody. And I personally can count the fights I've had on one hand. My approach was to let the argument diminish itself, buy the dude a drink, and then take his girlfriend home and make love to her. Bruce would walk up to a girl while he sat with a dude, and he would walk right up to her and say, baby, you want to dance? And I'm like, Bruce, you know, she's sitting with the dude. And Bruce would look at me and he'd go, fuck him. And that was Bruce's alter ego. He just had that alter ego. As far as his type of humor goes, I'll share one story with you. Hell, I don't even need to read this one. We were living together, and we had this table that had a mirror top on it. And we liked our knickknacks. We had some pretty cool shit. And I had a bronze hand that points up. It was a replica from a very famous artist in Germany during the Nazi regime. It was mounted on a marble stand. It was a bronze finger, and it held a crystal ball on it. I still have it to this day. My brother Philip said, you gotta bring it and use it as a prop. I'm like, oh, I'll bring my vodka instead. So it's sitting on the table. We're sitting around smoking dope, snorting coke, whatever it was we was doing, because we was doing it back then. And Bruce's girlfriend leaned down, picked it up, lifted it about 2 feet above the glass, turned it sideways. Crystal ball falls, slams on the glass. My eyes were so wide, I'm freaking out. Dave is sitting there just stunned. He can't believe it happened. And this poor girl goes, well, I didn't know that was 2 pieces. Oh. Bruce is rolling a joint. He didn't change expression. He sat there and he goes, you wouldn't know it was 2 pieces if they was laying side by side. And that was Bruce's humor. Yeah, and we smoked it good. I moved to California 30 years ago, September 1987. The two people it hurt me the most to leave
was my dad and Bruce. My dad gave me a card of a papa bear holding the tail of a baby bear. It said, "Do you have to go?" I showed that card to Bruce. He loved my dad. And Bruce hugged me and he grabbed me on the ass. He goes, "You gotta go?" I said, "Yeah, brother, I gotta go. I hope you can join me one day." I've kept in touch, very close to everyone from the neighborhood. Bruce and I remain truly soul connected. He and Dave came to California in 1992, along with most of my family for my wedding. Every time I came home to Memphis, Bruce and I spent as much time together as possible. We had great discussions over the years, ranging from music, guns and politics, religion, finances, our family, our loved ones, and the women in our lives. And Cassie, you were truly his soulmate. And I've been with him his entire life, and you are the one. And I know you know that, but he loves you dearly. I've been blessed to love and be loved by many. All of us in the neighborhood express love to one another. We hug and tell each other we love you often. Bruce and I never spoke to one another without the conversation ending with, "I love you, brother. And I love you too." When we'd see each other in public or private, we hugged each other as if it would be our last embrace. You don't know, honey. I have two recent messages on my iPhone from Bruce. Both of them end with, "I love you." My last text to Bruce simply said, "I love you, Bruce." And his last text to me was, "I love you, Paul." My friends that are in this room, Kim and Lynn and Brian, Alan, Albert, we tell each other I love you every time we talk. And it's something I cherish, and I hope that y'all have that in your life. I hope all of you have found that person in your life, or persons, friends or family, that you can have that relationship with, to share with, and to tell somebody that you love them more than anything in the world. Bruce is my brother. He is my best friend, and I love him. Thank you. Everybody raise your drink, whether it's alcohol, beer, or water, to our brother Bruce.
Yeah.
At this time, if there's anyone that would like to tell a story, share something about Bruce, the microphone is open. I'm going to lay it down on a towel so it doesn't make so much racket. Please come up here. Feel free to share a moment and an experience about your relationship with one of the finest men I know. Oh, y'all ain't that shy. God damn it. Let's go. Somebody out there's got a story. It can be a one-liner. It can be a one-liner. It can be a paragraph. It can just be thank you and goodbye. But
I want to tell you how I met Bruce. It's been many, many years ago. I met a young lady from Missouri driving a red Corvette. Well, she was young anyway. And we hung out for I noticed she always parked her car two doors down from my house. Never thought anything about it. Another buddy of mine called me and said, "A guy named Bruce Kingdon is going to beat your ass." I said, "I don't even know Bruce Kingdon." He said, "Well, Bruce just moved this girl from Missouri, all her furniture, to Memphis, and you've been dating her." I said, "I didn't know that." So I called this young lady, and do you have a boyfriend named Bruce? She said, well, yeah. I said, why don't you say something? And people who know me know that I would never date a married woman or somebody with a girlfriend. That's bullshit. But anyway, I called the young lady. I said, bring Bruce over here. She said, what? I said, bring Bruce over here. So Bruce and her come to my house. It was kind of tense. We talk, and we were buddies ever since that day till this day. And I know everybody here loved Bruce as I did.
Right on. Bruce.
Is it wireless? Well, I don't know if y'all know me or not. My name is Dwayne Haney. Cassie was my first wife. But in time, through the years, me and Bruce, we had our problems. We all met between me and Cass. We all had our problems. Me and Bruce got along. We had our little fights and stuff like that. Bruce was a good dude. Turned out to be out. I didn't know it at the time. Bruce was good. So me and him helped each other here and there, even with, you know, everybody in town. But it was a thing. But you know, you overcome everything. You know, I didn't understand it at first, but later on, yeah. Cassie and Bruce, they were together. They loved each other. I mean, that's just the way time goes. That's the way life goes. But I respected Bruce as much as I could through the years. You know, now we got a grandbaby right here. And I'm sorry that Bruce never gets to see this. I'll see it. I'll live for him. I'll see it through his eyes. I do everything that I can for Cass. Through everything, I will be right there. And hopefully Bruce, looking down on us, appreciates us. So it's about all I have to say. So.
Badge on the table, let me know. Sucker, hit the door quick.
Statue of limitation 7 years, right? When you age?
All right,
Danny,
go right ahead.
So was she? This might not be appropriate for, but it's the story about Bruce. And Paul. Me and Bruce met each other in, at Hillcrest in 7th grade. And we had homeroom and a bunch of other classes together. We both had really, at that time, long hair. And that's what...
I don't remember hair. What did I
win? Yeah, I mean, I'm just hanging on what's there, buddy. Look it up. We can Google it. But Bruce was really quiet in the homeroom. It took a long time for me and him to, even though we had several classes throughout the day, we became friends. We had a little bit in common, like music, getting high and partying. We both really didn't want to be at school. And then I got to be good friends with him, so he invited me over his house, and I spent the night over there in his neighborhood, which was Paul's neighborhood, and that's how I met Paul. And we were the youngest ones. We'd go down the neighborhood, Paul and all the other guys on the in their hood. I knew Bruce, like, these are my, like, we go out sad, but my heroes, you know, like, these are the guys I want to be able to like. I mean, and Bruce's family was really laid back, and Bruce was the one that stood out of the bunch. He was quiet, but he had his opinion. When he put it out there, it was, you knew it. Anyway, this is where the bad part comes up.
It's all good. Okay. There's no bad.
I don't know if Paul had just moved out of his house from home with his dad, or he was living there and just wanted to upgrade on TVs. And me and Bruce and okay, Kevin. Hell no. Look, man, this is my story. Say here. Dude, not me. Not me. Never. And not because I'm scared.
Statute of limitations
over. No. Not me.
Not me.
Ask any of my friends.
Who had a van? Did you have a van?
I never. Did I have a van?
Didn't have a van.
Who helped him?
Everybody's had a van.
Who helped him?
Fuck if I know. That was 40 years ago.
But they did
steal me a TV.
I just want to say, Andy, it was not even close. No.
Look, we're getting off track.
That you were so handsome when you were
cute.
What did he say? You were the
cutest little guy, man. I appreciate that. Hold up, that's a whole nice story.
But I'm curious who it is. When did you find out?
We all know who it is, but Niall's a bad name. And I probably shouldn't be saying anything in front of Bruce's daughter and all that, but that's when we were kids.
Well, we did good stuff when we were kids.
Right. But I mean, and Paul being Bruce's idol and brother, you know, we came across a up-to-grade TV, like flat screen be today, you know, they're just out. And Bruce said, hey.
That's a projector TV.
No, I don't know what it was, but he said, Paul needs one of those. So we skipped school to go get it. Like I said, we got it, but I mean, we acquired it. And, and somebody that resembles Kim took it over there. I'm not saying it was you, brother, but they. Anyway, that's how I really got to know Paul, because he loved TV, and then we were on tonight. What else can you? And me and Bruce, I'm not even going that story. I mean, as quiet as Bruce was, he was harmless. You know, you think, he don't do anything. One day we skip school, it was the last day of school. So we leave early. We walk over to Byron's neighborhood, walk all the way down to Brooks from Hillcrest, the construction company, and then there's this is Bruce's idea, it wasn't mine. I don't say that because he's not here to defend himself, I'm just, yeah, for real. He says, look, go get that, you know, there was a construction site going in work trucks. He says, look, we're going to jump in this truck. Keys are in it. Like, I don't know how, you know, I think him or somebody looked like him and I already checked it out. All right, man, I got it. I'm like, all right, we jump in the truck, we bend down, we start it up, and all of a sudden we take off down Brooks Road and all the construction workers like, what? Me and Bruce kept that truck for about a month. I mean, it had ladder racks on and everything. But going back that day, we were going back to school, last day of school. We had our gym clothes with us on the way back right there, cutting behind Hillcrest, getting, there used to be the arcade and there was a hospital back there. We were doing the back, build the back roads, whatever. Stop at a stop sign, I look left, right, and all of a sudden I go out, and a lady creams me. Bruce is like, back up, man, just keep going. So we go halfway to Hillcrest, which is only a few more blocks, truck overheats. We jump out, but we leave our gym, or one pair of gym clothes in there that says Hillcrest on them. So me and him run back to school, and as we get there, there's cops already there, we have an officer
Cobb.
Officer Cobb that patrolled that thing. So I'm heading north.
Yeah, I did.
My first thought is heading all back to my locker to find my gym clothes, so I'm going to put this shit on Bruce. But they weren't Bruce's shit.
They
anyway.
Had your name on them too, didn't they?
No, we didn't have anything, thank God. But anyway, they call us in there, the cops do, they think, you got a stolen truck? We're like, And Officer Cobb said, no, I don't think those guys would do that. They've done some trouble. Me and Bruce had already gone through some possession charges through school. But he didn't think we were thieves. We're not either. We borrowed that truck for 3 weeks.
Borrowed that truck.
And me drove it out there.
Fired it.
Shelby Force, we drove that baby everywhere. But I know that's not a really good example.
That's a great example of our life.
But I mean, Bruce being the quiet guy he was, I mean, and that's when I spent the night with him and I met everybody. Like, you do have a hell of a neighborhood, dude. Then when you moved over to apartments on Brooks or Winchester, we'd come over and watch you guys practice and, late, you know.
Good time.
Good time. Anyway.
All right, on. Quick, something came to my mind. There was an apartment complex behind Tammy Lane in Garden View Subdivision. Brian lived in the apartment complex, and it was off limits. You know, when you lived in a neighborhood, your parents didn't want you going to the apartment complex. I said, that's a rough area. Don't go over there, you know. Like, no, we're going over there. But Bruce wasn't driving for less than a year, and he totaled his car, drove into a parked car on St. James Avenue, parked out in front of the apartment complex, wound up in the hospital for weeks. So I'm like, you can't check out this early. You're 17 years old. You got to hang on there a little bit. He was a construction worker, stepped on a nail once, wound up in the hospital. It pushed the leather up in his foot. They almost were going to cut his foot off. You know, Bruce started out working with my father. We were in construction, did a lot of work together. And that's why there's several pictures in here of Bruce and even Albert. We did a lot of work for my dad. We did a lot of crazy work back in the day. So, you know, Bruce most definitely might have been the quiet one, but he could definitely have a voice, no doubt. Anybody else got anybody else like to say anything? Here we go. How you doing, brother?
What's up, brother? I'm Dale.
How you doing?
How y'all doing? I'm Dale. A lot of y'all might know me from around here. I've been friends with Bruce and Cassie a really long time. I met Bruce. I'm a carpenter. We was driving nails when we were 19, 20 years old when I met him. But I just got a real quick funny story. Got too many to stand up here. About a year ago or so, Cassie and Bruce and I were I can't even remember where we were. But we was getting ready to go, and me and Bruce was hugging. Now, I'm a hugger and a kisser, and I don't care who you are, you're liable to get a kiss. And I went to kiss Bruce on the cheek, and he turned, and we kissed each other straight on the lips. I think he liked it. But I gotta tell you, Bruce had just a super, super heart. We were true brothers. Cassie and I are brothers and sisters. We love each other very much. And, it's a privilege to stand up here and tell that. I hadn't kissed too many men on the lips and told people about it, but that was, it happened. It really did.
Right.
Thank
on.
You.
I'm going to play some music here, just throw in some Kansas, throw in some Bad Company. You guys kick back, go grab a cocktail, grab a beer, step outside, smoke a cigarette. Once again, where is my vodka? Okay, we're toasting my brother again, baby. Here we go. Thank you guys for coming. Let's hang out here as long as you want. The party's not over yet. We're just chilling out to our brother Bruce. Yes. Thank you so much.